You have to remember, there were no independent women back in biblical days. If a woman was single, she was living with her father. If her father died, the oldest man in her family took care of her. If she was married, she was supported by her husband. There was no such thing as a woman who had her own apartment, who was supporting herself without a man. There was no such thing as that. A man was taking care of a woman. If she's married, her husband. If she's single, it was her father. Now, if God would have told these men to get rid of all of their multiple wives and reduce down to one wife, it would have been a worse situation instead of a better situation. That would have caused these women and their children to be on the street begging bread, and some of the women would have become prostitutes for survival. And God realized it was better to simply pass laws to control this situation until the time came where things could be changed. And if you read the whole Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, you will see by the New Testament, Paul was teaching that a man should have only one wife. A bishop should be the husband of one wife. And if you read the whole New Testament, you will see that it was said that every righteous man should only have one wife. And see, we need to get this straight. We really need to get this straight, because if you look at the serious problem we have here in America, we have 70% of the black women unmarried, and most of them have children out of wedlock. It's essential that we get this situation straight. It is a mistake to say that the law says a man can have more than one wife. Look at the Torah, read it. It doesn't say that. What it does say is if a man has more than one wife, that certain laws apply to that situation to protect the women that are involved in that lifestyle. Without these laws, the women could be treated any kind of way. This is why these laws were made, to deal with this polygamous situation that God inherited from Egypt. These laws in the Torah are not dealing with laws expressing approval of an Egyptian lifestyle. The Israelites got polygamy from Egypt. Polygamy is nothing but camouflage fornication. That's all it is. And I know nothing else to call it but what it is. I believe in calling a spade a spade. I know not to call it by any other name. Polygamy, multiple wives, plural wives, is simply fornication camouflaged and marriaged. That's all it is. And by the time the New Testament was written, God sent Paul forth to let people know that he never approved of that lifestyle. He never commanded that lifestyle. That lifestyle was a lifestyle that he inherited when he separated Egypt from Israel. Now, don't assume because someone is prospering and healthy and doing well that God is pleased with their lifestyle. You can't go by that. That's erroneous thinking and it's faulty judgment, because I have heard it being taught. Well, if God didn't approve of polygamy, he wouldn't have blessed David. And you can look and see he blessed David. If God didn't approve of polygamy, he wouldn't have blessed Sodom. He would have cursed Sodom. That's erroneous reasoning. Let me put something to you. All throughout the Bible, we have examples of righteous people suffering. Look at Job. Job was one of the most righteous men that ever lived. Some people say he was the most righteous man that ever lived. Look at how Job suffered. If that reasoning was the proper reasoning, Job would never have suffered. Job suffered financial demise. He suffered the demise of his health. He suffered marital problems. He suffered in every way. And he was a righteous man. He was a law keeper. He kept God's laws. But yet he suffered. God allowed it to be. And on the other hand, you have unrighteous people. Even today, you have righteous people who are dying of cancer and other diseases, who have financial problems, who have marital problems, but they keep the law. They're righteous people. And you have unrighteous people who violate God's laws on a whim. Some are atheists, some are agnostics, and you have some that are out and out devil worshipers. And some of them are living very good lives. They prosper. Some are very wealthy. Some of the richest people in the world are devil worshipers. And they're very wealthy. Some have strong marriages. Some of them are in good health, very good health. You see that? And you couldn't possibly conclude that God is pleased with their lifestyle when some say he don't exist. He doesn't exist. The atheists say that. The agnostics say, well, you really can't tell. And then you got the devil worshipers that worship Satan. Surely God is not pleased with their lifestyle. He says, you should have no other God before me. But some of them are living very well. So you see my point. The point is, you can't go by blessings. You can't go by whether a person is doing well or whether they're not doing well to determine whether God is pleased with them or not. That's faulty judgment. You need to see that. And that point needs to be brought out because there's misteaching on that. And I believe God has sent me forth to straighten out these things and to prove that God is a God of monogamy. God commands monogamy. God is against polygamy. And I will prove that with the law. The Ten Commandments is the highest law. The Ten Commandments are above all the laws. Because the Ten Commandments was written by God himself with his own finger. And that is distinct. All the other laws in the Bible were written by men, influenced by God. But the Ten Commandments, God in his wisdom wrote the Ten Commandments himself with his own finger. That is infallible. The Ten Commandments are infallible. And the law, the Torah, the prophets, and the New Testament are founded on the highest law, which is the Ten Commandments. Now, I'm going to prove by the law that the Ten Commandments prove that God is a God of monogamy. The Ten Commandments command monogamy. Therefore, it speaks against polygamy as a sin. Now, I'm going to prove that right now. Let's take a look at the Ten Commandments.